Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
Welcome to Annette on America. This is Annette Bybee, recovering attorney, single mom to two teens and a tween. And just a few days ago, we had a lovely Easter weekend. I have to say it was very nice to see my Facebook feed filled up with Jesus. And I'm even today, a few days later, still seeing a lot of He is Risen and other wonderful reminders about our Savior. And I thought, gosh, if we did this more often, I think we would have a lot less trouble in our world. Unfortunately, that goes by the wayside fairly quickly and we get back into it. So my hope and prayer is that we try to take the Easter spirit forward with us throughout our week, every day, daily. So that's my goal. I'm not always going to make it, but I do pray throughout my day, every day. Many of you know I'm teaching middle school right now, and it's honestly the hardest job I've ever had. Just, who knew? I mean, I'm sure other middle school teachers know, but it's been very difficult for me, and I'm constantly praying for help. Anyway, so as I'm looking at the news this week, and I'm thinking about things, and I'm trying to prioritize what I want to talk about in order of importance to me, to the world, to my listeners. And I can't, well, all these things are really important, but the first thing that I've been thinking about a lot, because I've seen a lot of these stories on Facebook. I spend a lot of time on Facebook, in case you can't tell. By the way, if you're on Facebook, go to my radio show group, Annette on America radio show group. Just go find me, join me. We do polls every day. I ask a question and I ask for feedback. And I always like to get ideas from other people because I'm never going to know it all. All right. So the big story that I wanted to talk about first was the Riley Gaines story. And if you don't know who that is, she's a swimmer who had to swim against a dude pretending to be a woman. And she went and spoke at San Francisco State University. And she blasted them for praising a peaceful protest where she alleges she was attacked by trans activists after urging that transgender athletes be kept out of women's sports. Gaines, 23, threatened legal action against the school for its alleged failure to help her after droves of trans rights protesters pushed back at Gaines's controversial Thursday speech. I think it's funny that it's considered to be controversial. In days gone by, it would have seemed, well, silly or moronic to have to say that men shouldn't compete against women in women's sports. But now that's controversial. Video of the chaos shows dozens of protesters berating the former NCAA swimmer and the 12-time All-American champ following the speech. Gaines claims she was punched twice by a transgender woman and was forced to barricade for hours in a classroom. So it's not enough that they are going to compete against real women in sports, but then they have to come after them to beat them up as well. Can't beat up on a man, got to come after an actual woman. Following the mayhem, Jamila Moore, Vice President for Student Affairs and Enrollment Management, emailed students thanking them for taking part in the event. It took tremendous bravery to stand in a challenging space, Moore wrote. I am proud of the moments while we listened and asked insightful questions. I am also proud of the moments when our students demonstrated the value of free speech and the right to protest peacefully, she added. And where is her condemnation of the not-so-peaceful moments? After the statement was tweeted out, Gaines thundered, I'm sorry, did this just say peaceful? I was assaulted. I was extorted and held for ransom. So they have several pictures. If you go online and just type in Gaines and protests, you'll see. The protesters demanded I pay them if I wanted to make it home safely. Oh, so it's not just about what they believe. They wanted payment. Interesting. I missed my flight home because I was barricaded in a classroom. We must have different definitions of peaceful. In the school's notice about the incident, Moore offered Gaines no apology and instead focused on the student's commitment to standing with the trans community and diversity. I have no problem with peaceful protest. I actually welcome it. I was grateful to see a diverse crowd in the room during my speech, which I expressed multiple times, Gaines wrote. We had a great dialogue and listened to each other, but the ambush was the opposite of peaceful. Following the protest, the university's police department told the Post there'd been no arrests and that the school was probing the matter. We are conducting an ongoing investigation into the situation, a spokesperson said on Friday. The disruption occurred after the conclusion of the event, which made it necessary for UPD officers to move the event speaker from the room to a different, safe location. Speaking with Fox and Friends Weekend host Rachel Campos Duffy, Gaines said she demands justice for the alleged assault, announcing that she was planning to sue the school. The campus police did nothing. The dean of students was there and did nothing. There will be no repercussions unless I have something to do with it, she said. Gaines, a former swimmer at the University of Kentucky, has been a vocal critic of trans athletes participating in women's sports after competing against former UPenn swimmer Leah Thomas, with whom she tied for fifth place in a national swimming competition last spring. So this dude couldn't even get first place. So so that's obviously extremely frustrating that you have a woman who's standing up for women's rights and she gets hit by a man in a dress. Another story talked about how she was on the phone with her husband while she was being held in this room and she had gotten hit by a guy in a dress three times, and her husband is listening and he's like shaking because he's so angry. And I don't blame him. I would be shaking if I were angry, if I were listening to that as well. Some dude in a dress is going to hit a real woman for speaking up for women's rights. And the left must be very confused right now about what they're doing, because they can't quite decide what to do. But apparently it's no longer, women are no longer important. It's anybody in the LGBTTIA plus XXYY, XY, I don't know. As Rush used to say, LGBT WTF. But Megan Rapinoe and Sue Bird are among athletes who signed a letter opposing Protection of Girls and Women in Sports Act. So you have these women who are Olympic and Paralympic athletes who look like, I mean, they're obviously lesbian, and they are not going to support women because they've got to support trans women. I mean, how screwed up is this? We're not going to support women. We want equity. This is their statement. We believe that gender equity in sports is critical, which is why we urge policymakers to turn their attention and effort to the causes women athletes have been fighting for decades, including equal pay, an end to abuse and mistreatment, uneven implementation of Title IX, and a lack of access and equity for girls of color and girls with disabilities, to name only a few. Our deepest hope is that transgender and intersex, I don't even know what that means, kids will never have to feel the isolation, exclusion, and othering that HR 734 is seeking to enshrine into law. We think that only straight women should not be protected. Now, I added that last part, but that's obviously what they're saying. They're not interested in just plain old vanilla women who are just female, who are not calling themselves anything else. Those women are SOL. We have other more victimized people. So we're going to victimize women for the sake of men pretending to be women, or people who can't decide what their sex is because it's so fluid that it's running all over the place. See, I'm already really far away from where I was Easter weekend because this is so nonsensical and illogical. And what really bothers me, let me shift into the Dylan Mulvaney discussion. So there's a dude pretending to be a woman and acting like, not just a woman, but acting like a 12-year-old prepubescent girl and advertising on Bud Light. So Bud Light is now not going to be drunk by men, I'm assuming, but only maybe by, I don't know, maybe liberal men. Do liberal men drink beer? I don't know. I don't drink. I don't know the what goes on, but I can only assume that real men are not going to be drinking Bud Light anymore. And speaking as a woman who knows that she's a woman because she's a female adult, I know I'm not a biologist. I shouldn't be making that call about myself. But when I go in to get a pap smear, I can tell you I know I'm a woman. So I've got to gather my thoughts because there's so many things about this that bother me. So Dylan Mulvaney pretending to be a woman is all over the place. Dylan Mulvaney has not the first idea of what it means to be a woman. He's never going to get a pap smear. He's never going to give birth. He's never going to menstruate. He's never going to know what it's like to be in a female body. He can run around trying to look like, what's her name? What's the actress, the skinny actress from the 40s? I'll think of it, 60s, not 40s. Lovely woman, doesn't look anything like a man. But when you look at Dylan up close, and you look at some of his up closes, it's like, oh, look, you can see a little shadow underneath that makeup. Dude's never going to be a woman. Dude's never going to know what it's like to be a mother, what it's like to be a wife, what it's like to be a teenage girl. He's never going to know that. All of these men that put on skirts because they think they're going to make a better woman than an actual woman will never know. And this reminds me of the other thing I saw. I know I mentioned on this program a few weeks ago that there is an arcade here in town, One Up, over in Greenwood Village, that no longer has a women's bathroom. And they never contacted me back. I called up, left a message, haven't heard back. They no longer have a women's bathroom. They have a men's room and then a both men and women bathroom, but there is no just women's bathroom. I thought that's weird. I don't know why that's happening, but I saw recently another friend on Facebook posted pictures of the same situation in a hotel. I want to say Kansas City, someplace where you wouldn't expect it, but a hotel lobby with just a men's room and then a combined men and women's room. No women's room. So I'm thinking, what in the world is going on? All of a sudden, it feels like women are being completely devalued. You know, it used to be that, and I know some men still do this, a lot of men still do this, hold doors open, hold car doors open, treat women as if they're something special. Because men have always, or good men, have always revered women and understood how powerful we are. I don't mean physically powerful, obviously, but powerful as a person, as a human being that can give birth and then raise these children. And today, in today's world, also we have to go out and work full time, a lot of us. It used to be that we could stay home and have children and raise them, and that was hard enough. But now, since the 60s and the sexual revolution and all this quote unquote progress, we're out there working and raising children and cleaning the house and cooking for the most part. But just the essence of being a woman has always been highly respected and revered by good men and by other good women. And it feels like that's slipping away. If men can put on dresses or put on swimsuits and be looked at and accepted as women by like 40% of the country, what is special about women anymore? If a dude can be a woman, then there's nothing special about it. Well, I'm pushing back on that because I know how powerful women are. Obviously, Satan knows how powerful women are as well, or else he wouldn't be trying so hard to erase us. Not to mention the fact that all the gender confusion, all the transgendering, all the chopping of body parts, all the confusion stands in the way of procreation. And that's something else that Satan wants to do. He wants to confuse everybody to the point where it's no longer normal to just grow up knowing your gender, knowing you're attracted to the opposite sex, and that someday you're going to get married and have children. I can't believe I'm talking about this. If you would have stopped me 20 years ago and said, hey, guess what? In 20 years, there's going to be this thing called LGBTQTIA++ spirit animal, whatever, and that people wouldn't even know what their gender is, and that it's going to catch on like wildfire, and there's going to be a social contagion, and there's going to be all these teenagers and preteens who are being pushed into it by their parents and their teachers, I would have said, whatever, what planet are you coming from? That's not a thing. Everyone knows that there's male and female, with very, very, very teeny tiny exception of people who are born with both. But here we are. Here we are. And so that's the first thing I want to talk about today, because to me, that's extremely dangerous. When you start devaluing women, well, we've already devalued men. We already have to talk about toxic masculinity. Is it going to be toxic femininity next? I don't know what's left. We're all going to be neutered. We're all going to be neutral. Doesn't matter. I think that's what Satan wants. Everyone's neutral. You can't put a neutral and a neutral together and get children. Well, we've got to fight this, people. We've got to remember Easter. We've got to remember Jesus. We've got to remember who our Creator was. We've got to remember that we were created man and woman, male and female. And when you see bathrooms where there's no women's room, go raise holy heck with the manager, because it's not okay. We're not going to stand by, especially we women. We are not going to stand by and let you devalue us. And that's why I honor Riley Gaines, who is the real woman in the situation, not the man in the skirt, not the dude in the swimsuit pretending to be a woman. Riley Gaines is the real woman, and I salute her. All right, before I switch to the next story, which is also maddening. Maddening, I say. We live in a maddening world. Got to keep your sense of humor, because there are so many things that are maddening. So before I move on to my next topic, I just want to say you can find any of my past episodes if you've missed them. I'm sorry you missed them. You've missed a lot. Go to AnnetteTalks.com, go to YouTube, go to Rumble, go to any podcast provider, and you'll find me, Annette Talks. Or you can also look for Annette on Life, Liberty, and Happiness, which is what my podcast was called before I got this lovely radio show. Also, if you're a business, you have a great product or a great service, and you have good, strong American values, and you want me to talk about you on my show, email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com, and we'll talk. All right, so this is the next thing. Just when you think maybe the war on gas cars is dying down, nope, nope, nope. Biden declares war on gas cars. This is the latest. We've got to get this man out before he kills our country. We've just got to. I don't know if it's going to be too late or not. I'm glad we have the House. The House is going to have to step up and do something about this if this actually goes through. But here we go. It's never a good thing when the state picks winners and losers, but that's exactly what Joe Biden and his fellow Democrats are doing with their obsessive push to replace our gas-powered vehicles with electric ones. And he's followed by several governors, including ours here in Colorado. And what better way to do it than by unleashing the power of the regulatory state? The New York Times' Coral Davenport, reporting from an EPA test facility in Ann Arbor, Michigan, can hardly contain herself. Inside a secret government laboratory, behind a tall fence and armed guards, a team of engineers has been dissecting the innards of the newest all-electric vehicle with a singular goal: rewrite tailpipe pollution rules to speed up the nation's transition to electric cars. On Wednesday, the EPA is expected to propose ambitious greenhouse gas emission standards for cars that are so stringent, they're designed to ensure that 2/3 of the new vehicles sold in the United States are all electric by 2032, up from just 5.8% today. And the rules could put the nation on track to end sale of new gas-powered cars as soon as 2035. Oh yeah, that sounds brilliant. That's what we need. This is what we need. We have so many problems in this world. This is what we need. More electric vehicles. If you were listening, it was last week or the week before, I talked about one of the big problems with electric vehicles that people don't seem to realize is that the batteries, even in a little fender bender, the battery gets damaged and it's not fixable. So the car gets totaled. So you now have this decent car that gets totaled and now has to be stored someplace, not to mention the battery has to be stored and a new battery has to be purchased. So seems like quite a problem, a lot of implications. Go back and listen to my episode. So much for the free market. Team Biden's eco-fascists are hell-bent on forcing all of us into electric vehicles, and they're prepared to do whatever it takes, even if it means ignoring the will of the American people. Consider a new poll by the Associated Press, NORC Center for Public Affairs Research, and the Energy Policy Institute at the University of Chicago, which shows that most Americans aren't yet sold on EVs. According to the poll, just 8% of U.S. adults say they or someone in their household owns or leases an EV, and just 8% say their household has a plug-in hybrid. As for the people's preference, 41% say they're at least somewhat likely to switch to an electric, but nearly half, 47% say they're unlikely to do so. Respondents cited high prices and lack of charging stations as the primary deterrents, but they also could have listed the limiting cruise range of EVs or the bad batteries. That range isn't good to start with, but it's even worse during the cold winter months when a U.S. Oil and Gas Association president, Tim Stewart, says the battery's charge can be reduced as much as 40%. Ah, brilliant. You want to be here in Colorado and you're driving someplace in the snow that's further than work? Oh, and then you die because your battery slowed down in the winter? Yeah, that sounds brilliant. As for those high prices, the average cost of a new EV is more than $58,000, according to Kelley Blue Book. That's up around $2,000 from a year ago when we wrote about Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg's efforts to convince us that everyone benefits by buying an electric vehicle. Yep, whether you're a family farmer with an old F-150, a suburban mom with a used minivan, or a poor college kid getting to and from campus in a beat-up Accord, all you need is one of the Pothole Pete's coal-charged, battery-powered, overpriced beauties. I can tell you that I am nowhere near prepared to buy a vehicle worth $58,000. I couldn't spend half of that right now. And I would say that a big majority of us are in that same boat. And even if we could, we don't want it. As the Times laments, the history-making shift from the country's century-plus love affair with gas-driven vehicles still has a ways to travel. Ya think? Back in the day, Henry Ford used to say that his customers could have their Model T in any color they wanted so long as it was black. Similarly, Joe Biden seems to be saying that we're free to drive whatever cars we want as long as they're electric. The future of the auto industry is electric, said Scranton Joe during a visit to Michigan's Ford Rouge EV facility 2 years ago. I think they must mean Rogue. I don't think that there's a Ford Rouge, although it would be funny if there were. I have often thought when I've seen a Rogue driving around, that would be funny if they flipped the letters U and G and made it a rouge, like Moulin Rouge. Anyway, pretty sure that's what they mean. There's no turning back. Indeed, there'll be no turning back if Biden and California Governor Gavin Newsom get their way, and Governor Polis. As Fox News reports, Biden set a goal shortly after taking office for half of all cars sold in the U.S. to be zero emissions by 2030, and has repeatedly visited EV manufacturing facilities. As for Newsom, he's planning to phase out sales of gas-powered cars in the state by 2035. Can you say mass exodus from California if he actually does that? I lived in California at least half of my life, and people can't afford what he's selling. They just can't. California is not full of rich people. I mean, I think part of the problem here is we've got people like Gavi Baby and the big guy who have been on the government teat or, the CCP teat for so long that they have no clue what the rest of us are, what our lives are like out here. They think, no problem, everyone's got 58 grand. Just ask Newsom. He's got all that money over at SVB that was protected by the federal government. So he's never going to be broke again. He's protected. You look at Biden, who's not even going to be around for long, and he's gotten so much money from the CCP and from Ukraine and Russia and who knows where else. He has no clue. So these people who are up there in their high perches, making us do things, trying to make us do things that are good for us, are clueless. Here we should remember that the left is misleading us on electric vehicles. The statists' obsession with EVs isn't about climate change or the environment, it's about control. As Mark Tapscott notes, the central reason that the left loves EVs is that the process of forcing Americans to convert to electric-powered transportation will destroy forever the incredible freedom and prosperity associated with privately owned gas-powered vehicles. The future will instead be centrally controlled by rich elites and their corrupt politicians, power-hungry bureaucrats, and ideologically driven, quote-unquote, experts. I agree with him 100%. Because this is, you know, if we're going to be not owning anything and eating bugs and living in tiny houses within walking distance of whatever job we're allowed to go to where AI robots are actually doing the work, we don't need gas-powered vehicles. Gas-powered vehicles would tempt us to want to leave those little controlled, perfect little communities and go someplace beyond the range of electric vehicles. So we can't have our gas-powered cars. We've got to pretend like we're saving the world and we're saving the environment. So it's time to buckle up. Elections have consequences, and Joe Biden's regulatory commissars are just one of the more onerous examples of that truism. And if you thought his war on gas stoves was over the top, just wait till he comes for your gas-powered car. So this is one of those times where you need to, again, reach out to your U.S. representative, your U.S. senator, and tell them to push back on this new EPA regulation that Biden's trying to push. And let them know in no uncertain terms you're not getting rid of your gas car. We have got to do it because once it's fully switched, there's no going back. It's not like you can shut down oil refineries and gas stations and gas-powered production, gas car productions, whatever. You can't shut all of that stuff down and switch over to electric and then go back because we have another election. It's not that easy. It's pretty much impossible. So we've got to stop it before it happens. So make some noise. Call your senator. Call your representative. And I will be right back. I know they don't sound the way I planned them to be. But if you wait around the wall, I'll make you fall for me. I promise
you. The Bible is a revelation of the mind and will of God to man. And in that, we learn what God is and who He is. Hello, I'm Steve Gregg, host of the Narrow Path radio program. Every weekday, we open the Bible for discussion and would love to hear your questions, comments, and concerns about the Bible and about faith. Please join us.
Weekdays from 3 to 4 p.m., biblical answers to your theology questions. The Narrow Path is live and ready for your participation right here, weekdays at 3 p.m. and always 24/7 at thenarrowpath.com.
This is Carter Conlon, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now, in other words, you have everything today that you need to be able to do what God has called you to do. Whatever it is that he's calling you to do, he will equip you. When Jesus rose from the grave, he took the power of hell and destroyed it. He took everything that the devil would have to bring you or I into bondage, and he broke those chains, opened prison doors, gave us life, and gave us light. And he gave us the gifting that we need to do everything that we're called to do. You have everything you need right now inside of you. Will you answer the call? Jesus Christ is calling you today. Take time to talk to him about it because it's time to pray.
Ministries that tug at the heart. Gospel Sundays on KLDC 1220.
All right, Annette Bybee back here with Annette on America. And if you missed any of this show, you can find it on AnnetteTalks.com or any of the podcast providers or YouTube or Rumble. You don't want to miss any of this, people. I'm telling you. Okay, so before I go into my next big subject today, which is going to be China, I wanted to just mention a few things that are going on. Oh, well, for example, did you know that the COVID emergency is finally over? Joe Biden finally made it official this last Monday by signing HJ Res 7, which recognized what everyone else has known for well over a year. The COVID pandemic is long over. Yet it took Congress passing a bipartisan bill to get Biden to relinquish the temporary executive emergency powers that had been afforded back in early 2020 at the beginning of the pandemic. It was last September that Biden publicly stated that the pandemic is over. Wow, has it been that long? Jeez. Of course, that admission didn't stop the Biden administration from then arguing against any immediate ending of temporary executive powers. The White House just earlier this year maintained that ending the emergency powers would create wide-ranging chaos and uncertainty throughout the healthcare system. Really? The more important question is whether the federal government's use and abuse of emergency powers actually resulted in more harm than good. So this is just an example, the most recent example of what happens when you allow government to grab power, when you're scared. And so when you get scared, I'm so scared of this COVID. I saw so much fear of COVID from the beginning. Many, many, many of us knew it was ridiculous. But so many people played into that fear that when government, i.e. the president or governors or county commissioners or whoever gets hold of that power, they don't just say, okay, I will only hold it until I absolutely have to. I'm going to let go of it as soon as I can. Nope. You got to pry it out of their cold, dead fingers. You got to pass a law to get them to let go. So you guys, I hope we've all learned from this. Don't let it happen again. Do not give in to your fear. Let your fear of a powerful government be stronger than your fear of whatever it is they're using to grab that power next time. All right, let's see, what else? I guess there was some classified documents that were leaking up at the top, and the White House first said, no, they're not leaking, and then they said, oh, yeah, it leaked, but you shouldn't be sharing it. That makes me feel very safe. Let's see, what else? North Korean nuclear arsenal nearly doubled since 2017. That sounds great. Okay. There were a few other things I was going to mention, but I'm not seeing them right now. So I want to get on to my story. Oh, Catholics are under FBI surveillance. At least one FBI field office basically spied on Catholics. Those darn dangerous religious people. Now, the LGBTQTIA+++, those are all good. Every single last one of them is a good person. Even when they're shooting up schools, we don't dare say anything negative about that whole group of people. But Christians, they are dangerous. So be careful out there, Christians. All right, let me get to the other story. This is a big one. Okay, China. And it was interesting. I had a dream the other night, and I was switching to a new job. And someone said, this is what you're going to do now. And they gave me a big book. And on the front of it, it said China. So I'm not sure what that means. I've been trying to get a class. I teach for a university online. And they offer a hybrid class on China, but not fully online. And I keep thinking, as soon as they get that thing online, I want to teach that class so bad. I want to sink my teeth into it. So maybe that's coming down the pike. Or maybe I'm just supposed to keep talking about China. But what we have right now is Taiwan warns Chinese misstep could lead to uncontrollable world war outbreak. And I told you I'm teaching middle school. I'm teaching, I'm getting ready to start on World War II this week. Last month, we talked about World War I for a very long time. That is such a confusing, crazy war. World War II is a bit more straightforward. But either way, how is it that we possibly may be looking for World War III now? I mean, it's pretty unbelievable. But here we go. Taiwan is sounding alarms over Chinese military drills that it says could mistakenly spark an uncontrollable war that would draw in countries from around the world. I don't think there's anything mistaken about what China is doing. The Chinese military exercises this couple of days have been very serious, Taiwanese Foreign Minister Joseph Wu told Fox News. If you look at the sorties of the Chinese Air Force together with the ships, they're coming very close to Taiwan, and any accidents might spark an uncontrollable war in between Taiwan and China. And if other countries are trying to intervene, it might be the start of war of a great scale. Well, I want to know if they sent any Chinese spy balloons over Taiwan. That's when you know they're getting serious. The comments come as large-scale Chinese military drills entered their third day Monday when the Chinese military declaring it that it is ready to fight if Taiwan were to attempt to declare its independence from the mainland. I thought they already did that. They've been calling themselves Taiwan ROC for a very long time, so not really sure what they're waiting for. They have a few ideas, but the theater's troops are ready to fight at all times and can fight at any time to resolutely smash any form of Taiwan independence and foreign interference attempts, the military said Monday, according to the AP. The drills China has run played out similarly to those the country conducted in August after Taiwan received a visit from then House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, this time coming on the heels of a meeting between Taiwanese officials and the House Speaker Kevin McCarthy. So in other words, whenever the U.S. shows any kind of solidarity by sending the Speaker of the House to Taiwan, China starts rattling its sabers. Like the previous incident in August, multiple warships and planes have reportedly crossed the median line of the Taiwan Strait, which for decades was understood by both sides as a boundary that military force should not cross for fear of escalating to war. But China has disregarded the boundary in more recent military drills, insisting the line is imaginary in nature. It's like little shark bumps, right? Shark coming up to the little imaginary person and bumping them to see, oh, are you going to fight back? You're going to fight back? You're going to fight back? Wu warned that the recent drills have shown that the Chinese threat to the independently governed island have continued to increase, arguing that it will be crucial for the U.S. to continue to show support for Taiwan as a way to deter aggression from the mainland. If you look at the Chinese military threat against Taiwan is being increasing, that diplomatic assault against Taiwan is also being increasing. I think he means being increased, Wu said. And therefore, for the United States lawmakers or the administration to show support for Taiwan, it is very critical. And this time around, we saw a tremendous show of support coming from the U.S. Congress. In other words, Taiwan saying, help, please, U.S., please, 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 we cannot beat China alone, which is obvious. They're not going to. But, of course, we have big problems, like, oh, for example, the fact that we're sending billions and billions of dollars to Ukraine. And we're already in a proxy war with Russia. And Russia and China are cozied up to each other. So what if China decides to take some ownership of the Russian-Ukraine war? What if they decide to go in there and start propping up Russia? Are we then going to be in a proxy war with China and Russia? And what if we are so busy dealing with that we then lose sight of what's going on in Taiwan and China decides to attack? I mean, these are a lot of big ifs, but our military is not at peak readiness. And Biden's been using all of our strategic oil reserves to try and keep gas prices down at the same time as he's trying to get rid of gas-powered cars. So we're not in a great position to be in an active war. We can't be in a hot war right now. I'm just surprised China hasn't made a move already. It makes me wonder if there's just a lot of weakness within that government, which I'm sure there is. Gosh, I want to teach that class on China. Okay, so, and if you listen to my episode, I want to say it was a few months ago. I'm not good at remembering how long ago things were. I always get things messed up. But I had a gentleman on who wrote a book about how China basically owns Hollywood. And I was quite shocked when I learned about it. I knew that China was heavily influencing Hollywood, but I didn't know how, to what degree they owned us. And a big part of that is because if anyone wants to have their film distributed to the 1.4 billion people in China, then it has to get past their censors. And their censors will not allow anything in it that has anything negative about China or anything that they don't agree with. And so that's one way, just heavy censorship of anything that goes into China. And everybody wants their movie to go to China so they can make money. But the other thing is that they finance something like 40% of the movies in Hollywood. So between those two, they practically own Hollywood. The interesting solution that this gentleman had was that we need to gain a bigger audience in India, because they also have a huge population, obviously. We could replace China with India. That would be one way to solve that. Another thing is that we have things that we can do to start countering China's dominance, because China is set to basically become take our place as superpower. Okay, one of the biggest challenges presented by China as compared to the USSR is the depth of the Chinese penetration of America's economy, politics, culture, and society. Hollywood, culture. The Heritage Foundation released a thorough report titled Winning the New Cold War, A Plan for Countering China on March 28th. So this is pretty recent. In an address to introduce the plan, Senator Marco Rubio declared that the report will help us to wake up and to realize that we are not just in a competition, we are in a conflict. Anyone with half a brain in Washington knows this, by the way. It's just that a lot of people there are bought off. Don't kid yourselves, all right? Turtle, Mr. Senate Majority Leader, or Minority Leader right now, his wife is fully, she comes from China. Her family is connected to the CCP. So we have a lot of that in Washington. A lot of politicians are bought off by the CCP. All right, it's time to acknowledge reality. The United States is in a new Cold War with the PRC, People's Republic of China, Heritage President Kevin Roberts wrote, expressing a sentiment espoused throughout the report. This foregrounding of the stark reality of the geopolitical competition with China characterizes Heritage's expert analysis, cutting through the typical attitude of the corporate media and President Joe Biden, also bought off by the CCP. That's why this is advice for the next president, because you know that Biden is never going to do anything to cut back on China's dominance. He has no problem with that as long as he's getting his 10%. For decades, America has followed a bipartisan and naive policy of unfettered engagement with China. Can you say Obama? Which has allowed the Chinese Communist Party to entrench and enrich itself within the international system while facing no consequences for its aggression abroad totalitarianism at home. China now uses its wealth and technology to supercharge a policy of civil-military fusion, linking economics and military strategy. One of the biggest challenges presented by China as compared to the USSR, is the depth of what I already said, all those different things, economy, America's economy, politics, culture, blah, blah, blah. So what can we do to counter these things? Well, the Heritage has a plan with 10 things we can do. Number one, ban dangerous Chinese apps. TikTok and other CCP-linked apps are incredibly popular, especially among American youth. These apps threaten personal privacy and national security. Heritage recommends an outright ban of TikTok and a more aggressive, risk-oriented approach to assessing foreign-owned information technologies in the U.S. This would take very little in terms of new law, and the federal government has processes in place to monitor or ban these apps. Congress is already debating this issue, so the prognosis looks good. Let's just not go with some of these big bills that they're trying to pass that give the government more power. All you need is a bill that says ban TikTok. That's it. We don't need to give more power to the Commerce Department or any other department. Just ban it. Speaking of banning, number two, ban the import and sale of Chinese drones. Although a lesser known issue, CCP-linked drone manufacturers, specifically DJI, dominate the commercial and recreational markets. As with TikTok, all information collected by those drones, the ones, you know, that are flying above us, is stored on CCP accessible servers. Can you say China spy drones? Local, state, and federal agencies have used DJI drones. Not too bright. Some given as free gifts during the pandemic to monitor every aspect of life in these cities, including the precise location of critical infrastructure and other sensitive information. That makes me nauseous. Bans on these drones can be included in the annual National Defense Authorization Act or implemented via executive order. Educating non-federal officials about the drones could reduce the threat at the state and local levels. We do not need Chinese spy drones flying around, and it's very disgusting that that happened during COVID. Hey, look, America, this is what we use to spy on our people and keep them in line all the time. Do you want some of ours? Oh, and by the way, we are going to take the information ourselves as well. Sound like a deal? Here you go, free drones. Number three, ask the Uyghurs how they like Chinese technology. If you don't know what Uyghurs are, look them up. U-I-G-H-U-R-S is sometimes spelled. It's spelled different ways. Just look up Chinese Uyghurs. Number three, risk manage inbound investment. China's direct investment in American firms peaked in 2015, but its national security implications remain. Often funneled through middlemen who camouflage Chinese involvement, CCP-linked investments still reaches into the billions annually. The federal government has the tools to properly manage and review this. The 2018 Foreign Investment Risk Review Modernization Act enabled the Committee on Foreign Investment in the U.S. to scrutinize these investments more. Expanding definitions in FIRMA can empower us to address all forms of Chinese investments, even through intermediaries, while direct legislative language can force reviews when agencies decline to use the power granted by law. In other words, stop letting China invest in everything here. And you know that goes directly against what Biden wants, because he likes to be invested in himself personally. Number four, reject damaging ESG policies. This is a duh on so many levels, not just for China and keeping China out. So-called environmental, social, and governance policies have been a debacle, that's putting it mildly, for investors and a sop to Chinese-linked firms, which control the supply chains for ESG-mandated renewable energy. ESG weakens the U.S. while strengthening its greatest foe. Congress can end this damaging strategy through legislation, which it indeed did before President Biden vetoed it, of course. Congress should continue pushing to end ESG through law and work to advance the understanding of ESG's danger in the corporate sector. Yes, we need to be done with ESG, period. Even if China didn't exist, we need to be done with that. Number five, increase munition production and arm Taiwan. This issue is paramount to countering China, particularly as the CCP has advanced its aggression toward Taiwan, like we just talked about. The Heritage Report acknowledges the trade-offs inherent in the decisions about arms sales and transfers and proposes an augmentation of our defense industrial base to overcome these scarcity issues going forward. Today, we can prioritize Taiwan by sending critical munitions, ensuring that capabilities sent elsewhere do not overly affect the defense of Taiwan, drawing down our own stocks in accordance with the law and facilitating arms purchases from other nations. So let's keep Taiwan ready to defend itself. Number six, foster innovations in the U.S. maritime and shipping sectors. America's uncompetitive and outdated shipbuilding and shipping sector diminishes U.S. competitiveness, undermines the resilience of the economy, constrains the nation's ability to mobilize and sustain a wartime economy, and meet the U.S. Navy's global responsibilities, according to the report. Can you say supply chain problems during COVID? The major stumbling block to reform is the restrictive Jones Act, which should be repealed and replaced with a law focused on promoting innovation in the maritime sector. The Jones Act, or the Merchant Marine Act of 1920, mandates that U.S.-made and U.S.-owned vessels transport goods between American ports and that U.S. citizens operate the vessels. Well, that's stupid. I mean, it's one of those feel-good things. Free market solutions will allow the creativity of American industry to excel, developing novel methods of transportation, growing our shipbuilding and shipping capacities, and backstopping American naval power. Sounds good. Number 7, expand export controls. The U.S. policy of engagement with China had allowed the chronic export of technologies used to advance China's military aims. Legislation has since limited certain foundational technology exports, but the federal bureaucracy has failed to implement controls by refusing to label these technologies. This is one of the big problems with bureaucracy, that they're not responsive to what Congress wants. They're worthless. Congress must exercise its oversight power and force executive branch agencies to make these determinations in line with the law so as to cease the transfer of critical security technology to the CCP. Duh, we're not supposed to be sending them this kind of technology. Number 8, and this will never happen, hold China accountable for COVID-19. Regardless of the pandemic's specific origin, a great deal of evidence has shown the CCP deliberately covered up the virus, allowing it to spread unchecked. Since then, the CCP has stonewalled investigations into its behavior, using its leverage at the WHO to avoid accountability. The U.S. government should cease funding the WHO until it conducts a thorough investigation of China's involvement in the pandemic and all financing of Chinese biomedical research, and propose unbiased international standards by which pandemics can be detected and limited without interfering with national sovereignty. Yeah, go! Number 9, the Pacific Islands should be prioritized. China has been focusing on this region, seeking to cut off the U.S. from its Indo-Pacific allies. We need to focus more on getting those islands back. Establish a Quad Select Initiative. The Quad, that's U.S., Australia, India, and Japan, is one of America's most important initiatives to counter China. It links the key players in the Indo-Pacific and builds bridges for future cooperation. So we need to focus on strengthening the Quad. All right, so these are just low-hanging fruit. We need to do those 10. If you want to find those, just go on to the Federalist and find the article about things we can do to counter China's dominance. And I would recommend sending that to your senator or congressman or both. All right, as always, I want to end my program with a fun story from my favorite news source, the Babylon Bee. "I'm a victim," yells trans activist while punching woman in the face. San Francisco. Amid the controversy surrounding the attack on women's rights activist NCAA swimming champion Riley Gaines, a new report indicated a burly male trans activist shouted, "I'm a victim," as he punched a woman squarely in the face. "You people don't get it," shouted the muscular blue-haired man as he repeatedly struck the tiny woman in the jaw. "Trans people have the right to expose their genitalia in locker rooms to anyone they want. Stop threatening us and being violent." A former college swimming champion, Gaines has drawn the ire of the trans activist community after speaking out against the inclusion of biological male athletes like Leah Thomas in competitions with females. Trans activists, conversely, are aggressively defending their totally sane and logical rights to bully and demoralize women by destroying them in their sports and requiring them to feel violated by sharing locker rooms with naked men. "If men who think they are women don't have the right to walk around naked in women's locker rooms, what rights do they have?" shouted another muscular male activist as he kicked an unconscious woman in the ribs. "We must be protected and defended." At publishing time, as the battered women were being hauled off to the hospital under police custody to receive treatment for injuries before facing charges of committing dangerous crimes against the trans community, the trans activists who physically assaulted the protesting women have reportedly been isolated by law enforcement to protect them from the general public. As I often say on Facebook, go find me, Annette on America Radio Show group. But as I often say on Facebook, we now live in the upside down. And that's something that I forgot to mention from the other story, was not just that Riley Gaines had to compete against a man and share fifth place with him and then have him be Woman of the Year. She also had to see his junk exposed in the women's locker room. Yes, that's what they're fighting for. They want to keep their junk, put it in a swimsuit, win, come back to the locker room, expose their junk. And they want everyone to say, this is the way it's supposed to be. That's the worst part of it, is that they want us to lie. They want us to look them dead in the face and say, you're right. You're a woman that's got dude parts, and you should be able to compete with women who only have women parts, and you should be able to expose your junk, and we should be completely okay with that. We're so sorry. The upside down. We're living in the upside down. Okay, so I am now out of time, of course, after not getting to in nearly all the stories I wanted to get to, but we live in a crazy world. So again, if you missed any of this show or any other of my shows, go to AnnetteTalks.com, or you can find Annette on America on YouTube, Rumble, or any of the podcast providers. Well, I thank you for joining me today and listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America, and join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all things America.